Hey, space friends, this week I'm talking about cryoconite holes. What are cryoconite holes? That sounds pretty complicated. Cryoconite holes, even though they have this kind of funny name, are actually pretty simple in concept. Cryoconite holes are essentially little places inside of glaciers where microbes can live their best lives. It's pretty cool, literally speaking. Microbes are able to live in these little dirt pucks inside of glaciers because of a really cool thing that happens. Essentially, dirt and dust get blown onto the top of a glacier, and because that dirt and dust is pretty dark, it begins to absorb more sunlight. And as it absorbs more sunlight, it begins to melt down the glacier. And so these little tiny pockets and holes begin forming on the top of a glacier where this dirt is melting down the glacier slowly, slowly, slowly. As these holes melt down, the lid over the top of them freezes again. So you get all these little pockets of dirt inside of a glacier, maybe a foot or two down, and they're these little isolated universes in a way, kind of little island universes. Why that's really cool is because often with that dirt or dust come microbes. So you actually have all these tiny little ecosystems all throughout a glacier living just inside of it. So cryoconite holes are essentially dirt holes inside of a glacier that often host microbes living inside of them. It's just really cool. Cryoconite holes were first described by someone who was visiting Greenland, a geologist, in 1870, and he coined the term cryoconite. But as many researchers have often said, cryoconite is really just a fancy word for dirt on a glacier. As some of you already know, I was able to investigate cryoconite holes up close and personal in Antarctica, which was just so awesome. It was part of my mission and expedition to Antarctica to film life underneath the ice. And what better life underneath the ice than life underneath glacier ice? I was able to hike up a glacier for the very first time, which was very difficult, but I did it with the help of a team who studies cryoconite holes as their main job. This team is really awesome. It consists of researchers Pacifica Summers, Dorota Porozinska, and Adam Solon. They, all three of them, helped me climb up a glacier and actually look at cryoconite holes and film the life underneath the ice there. Once we got on top of the glacier, we drilled down into it so that we were able to take out an ice core, and underneath that ice core was the dirt puck, the cryoconite hole of all the microbes and dirt that had melted down into the glacier. It was really amazing to actually see this dirt puck emerge from inside of this glacier. But what was even more amazing was when I defrosted that dirt puck later that day and was able to film all of the microbes that live inside. If you haven't checked it out yet, go to lifeundertheice.org. That's where I put all of my videos of all of these microbes, and you can actually have the experience of exploring and looking around these microbes the way that I did when I was sitting at my microscope in Antarctica. Lifeundertheice.org is a virtual microscope, so anyone can go and go on a tardigrade hunt with just a web browser, which was just really fun to put together, and I really love sharing it with more and more people because not everyone has a microscope, but everyone can have access to exploring all the microbes in Antarctica through that. There's a few really interesting things to think about when it comes to cryoconite holes. Not only are they fascinating for hosting entire microbe ecosystems inside of glaciers and be able to thrive, but there's a lot of other parts of the equation that are really interesting to think about. For instance, one of my previous videos, we talked about how microbes are actually found to be living in wildfire smoke and how wildfire smoke can be carried around the entire globe. Well, when thinking about that, microbes can actually be carried into Antarctica through so many different methods, either locally or from far away. What researchers have found is that while a lot of the microbes in these cryoconite holes in Antarctica reflect the microbes that exist in local streams nearby so that they haven't come from too far away, what is interesting is that these little isolated island universes that live inside of glaciers are their own unique ecosystems. So while they might have the same biodiversity as the local area, they have kind of their own makeup, and each one is slightly different because they're isolated for so many years, so they sort of have their own dynamics at play. This is something to keep in mind in the context of climate change, because while wind might be able to float microbes into Antarctica from far away, only the hardiest microbes have been able to survive. So things like tardigrades and certain types of nematodes and rotifers are living happily in Antarctica because they are the hardiest microbes that have been able to survive. But as climate change warms things up, other microbes might find Antarctica not so hostile, and they might actually be able to take a foothold in Antarctica, which means that these microbes that have had Antarctica all to themselves might find themselves competing in a gladiator sort of arena for space and for food and all sorts of things. So that's an interesting thing to think about when it comes to climate change in Antarctica. It might not immediately kill out microbes, but it might create weird competition dynamics that those microbes haven't seen for a very long time. Overall, cryoconite holes are incredibly important for science because it allows scientists to actually study how habitats get established. By having all of these little isolated mini ecosystems, they can study how those ecosystems get established, what happens in them, what power dynamics are at play, and that helps them map into how larger habitats get established. Deciding how things like entire forests or prairies or things of that nature get established and how they start and how the microbes start to set up shop in those areas is actually quite difficult and complex. But by having these miniature habitats scattered throughout glaciers in Antarctica and other places around the world, scientists can really get a foothold on how, well, microbes get their foothold. Okay, that's it for me this week. As always, check out the YouTube description below, because not only is there a shout out to all the really awesome patrons that are helping me create videos like this one, but also there's relevant links to this episode. Go check that out, have a read, and also please do consider becoming a patron if you haven't already. I produce these videos independently, and so your support on Patreon means a whole lot, and I always appreciate it. I will see you all next week.